that you natural.
Lady,
and you need to attack you. Like, I keep my game tackle.
Yo,
yeah, I'm so nappy. Cause that be natural.
The infamous.
And you looking tacky cause I keep my game tackle.
I'm so pretty, I'm so fabulous, I'm so natural. It's like it's a taboo. I'm so filthy, got the tattoo. Fucking these bitches like I own Rabu. All my business with my platoon. Give me minutes like I'm a taco. Y'all is jersey on that cartoon. And I'm still talking.
Back to afros and baby hairs, and thank you once again for joining me in the reading room for book review number 18, and this will be on The Daughter of Black Ice. So if you're interested in hearing, you know, details of this book as well as my thoughts and opinions, then please stay tuned.
I do not promote this book to anyone who is under the age of 18. If you are under the age of 18, please get your parents' consent and or supervision. Now that I've gotten that out of the way, let's get into this book review.
So, I'm going to start off by reading the back of the book. And it reads, from the time she was born, Aisha has only known pain from her abusive mother. She never understood the reason on why her mother hated her with a passion, but there is only so much one person can take before they break. When she finally releases the anger and rage in her heart, she'll realize that she's a far cry from a normal person. She realizes that the killing comes naturally, like any hidden talent, and that she enjoys setting free the evil in her heart. Her mother does everything in her power to stop her from discovering who she really is. The child of a devil, the daughter of Black Ice. I do want to say that even though the back of the book is saying that the girl's name is Aisha, actually in the book the girl's name is Faith. So I don't know if that's a typo or some type of error, but in the book her name is Faith. On to the characters. We have Faith, who is Black Ice's daughter. We have Regina, who is Faith's mother. We have Brandy, a lady that tries to help Faith and ends up as one of Black Ice's sex slaves. You have Nakia, a girl who is already in Black Ice's captivity. You have Dr. Monroe, aka Antonio, who is a doctor who is treating Faith. And she thinks he's very handsome, and she actually starts a relationship with him. We also have Erica, who is a nurse at the hospital that doesn't really care much about Faith. There is also Sabrina, who is Dr. Monroe's, aka Antonio's wife. You have Carlton and Kevin, who are Antonio's twin sons by Sabrina. You have a Veronica, who is Antonio's daughter by Sabrina. And then you have Mako and Travis. And these are the best friends of Carlton and Calvin, the twins of Antonio. This book starts off with Regina beating Faith with a broomstick. Regina is, of course, a crackhead, but she is big-boned. And she's very abusive and torturing and enslaving and selling her 20-year-old daughter for crack and money. She has been forcing her to have sex with men since she was a little girl. She even threatens to kill her with the 380 she keeps in her bosom if she tries to run away or fight back. From the beginning of this book, you can tell that the mother actually hates her daughter with a passion simply because of who her father is and because of all the abuse he took her through. The mother ends up beating her daughter unconscious. In the next chapter, Faith wakes up with her arms and legs tied to the bed, and she is in excruciating pain. While she was unconscious, the mother allowed men to come in and have their way with her. However, when Regina comes to the room, Faith starts to talk smack to her mom, and then Regina takes a hot curling iron and burns the girl's tongue and throat until the curling iron got stuck. Then she stuck the curling iron in the girl's lady part. Soon thereafter, Black Ice and Faith comes out, and she was able to break free from being tied to the bed, and she begins to beat her mother senseless. The mother tried to use her gun, but Faith kicked it out of her hands, clean across the room. Then she pulled down her mom's pants and began to insert that same curling iron into her lady part. Regina was able to eventually squirm back over to where her gun was located. She tried to shoot Faith in the forehead, but Faith dodged the bullet and ran. She did catch a few of her mother's bullets before she was able to unlock and open the front door, but she did manage to make it out of the apartment and down three floors and out onto the street. She was bleeding bad, yet she kept running until this brown-skinned lady noticed her and screamed for help. She assisted Faith until eventually Faith was going in and out of consciousness. The brown-skinned lady did call the ambulance, but a black van pulled up before the ambulance came, and out jumped Black Ice and his men. Black Ice stood behind the brown-skinned woman who was kneeling down to help Faith, who was now laying on the ground. You know, Faith is knocked out unconscious. Faith saw Black Ice, but couldn't warn the brown-skinned lady because she didn't really have enough energy. Black Ice ended up clocking the woman in the back of the head, and when she looked around to see who had hit her, he hit her again right in the temple, knocking her unconscious. Then he ordered his men to put the girls in the van, but he made it very clear to them to not to hurt the dark-skinned one. Black Ice hopped in the driver's seat and took off. He made eye contact with Regina, Faith's mom, as she was following Faith's blood trail to finish her off. As soon as she saw Black Ice and read his lips, she started running in the opposite direction. He had basically told her he was coming back for her. Wakes up in what appears to be an apartment, and then she sees the woman who tries to help her standing there naked and trembling, and another light-skinned skinny girl by the name of Nakia standing there naked and trembling as well. Also, of course, Black Ice was there. Black Ice pretty much tries to make a deal with Faith by telling her that she can pick one of the girls and remove a body part from them, and he will answer all of her questions and tell her why her mother hated her so much. However, Faith couldn't bring herself to do it, so Black Ice does it for her. He picked Nakia, hangs her from the ceiling by a rope, then cuts off her lips before he stabs her in the bladder and rips open the wound for her organs to fall out. Of course, both the ladies, Faith and Brandy, are afraid. Faith ends up vomiting at the sight. Anyway, Black Ice tells Faith she isn't ready yet and puts a towel or a rag back over her face that knocks her back out. Wakes up after feeling someone sticking her with a needle. She sees a lady running out of the room holding her eye and is in a nurse's uniform. Faith was swinging on them. Soon her doctor enters the room and tells her someone did a number on her, stopped her bleeding, removed a bullet, and dropped her off at the hospital. Faith thinks Dr. Monroe is very handsome, and he thought Faith was pretty as well, especially her eyes. When he asked her, did she remember anything that happened to her, she decided not to tell him about her mother's abuse, the rape, or about her evil father out of fear he would judge her. So she said she didn't remember much. Over the next 2 weeks, Faith and Dr. Monroe, aka Antonio, got really close, talking and hanging out in her hospital room. After Faith had gotten better and closer to being released, her and Dr. Monroe began to make out. So this is a day he comes into her room, they've been talking, and he decides to make out with her in the hospital bed. Anyway, however, she tried to tell him she was not who he thought she was and didn't deserve a man like him, but Dr. Monroe stopped her and kissed her deeply. Faith did mention to him that once she was released, she didn't have family nor a home to go to. So he gave her the key to one of his condos, a cell phone, and a credit card to go buy some clothes. He told her that she could live with him. Anyway, once Dr. Monroe left the room, his nurse Erica came in with her face twisted up and had an attitude with Faith because she actually had a crush on Dr. Monroe. And she hated skinny thoughts because they always got lucky while chubby girls like her got left behind and had to continue working 12 hours a day. She ended up rubbing Faith the wrong way, and Faith basically told her that wasn't her fault, that the doctor didn't want her. Soon after the girls went back and forth and Erica left the room, there stood Black Ice. He had come to bring Faith some gifts, basically, you know, just weapons, which was an axe and a blade. Black Ice was still trying to tell her that she was his daughter, and killing is what was in her blood. Faith ended up throwing an axe at her dad but missed because he moved his head. However, since Erica, the nurse, had opened the door to come back in the room, the axe ended up getting stuck in the side of her head. Eventually, she took off running to find a doctor. That's when Black Ice told her that they had to kill everybody because they don't leave evidence or witnesses. So he took off to start killing everybody on the fifth floor of the hospital and told Faith to come on. Faith was thinking about Antonio, aka Dr. Monroe, and didn't want this situation to stop him from liking her, so she followed behind her dad, watching him slice and dice nurses and patients. Soon, Erica, the nurse, tried to make a getaway, and Faith was on her trail. They ended up face-to-face in the parking lot. You know, she had already lodged an axe in the girl's head. Then she made the girl lose a hand when she was trying to get away. Now, in the parking lot, Faith ended up stabbing her about 19 times, but when she didn't kill the girl, Black Ice actually finished her off by stomping the axe further down into the girl's head. I hope y'all understood that. Faith ended up ditching her knife and running back to her hospital room to get the bag Dr. Monroe / Antonio had given her. Then she hit the street. It was about 3 a.m. She was still in her hospital gown and it was raining. She walked the streets of Queens until she saw an abandoned, rundown, and boarded up house. She entered from the back door after removing a board, and that's where she ended up sleeping after crying herself to sleep. When Dr. Monroe Antonio made it to his penthouse, he could hear that someone was in the shower, so he took out his gun and went into the bathroom where Faith was taking a shower. They greeted each other, and he asked her why didn't she stay to be discharged properly. Of course, she lied, and then they ended up having a night of ecstasy. Now, Faith and Antonio have been living together for 6 months. However, Antonio is gone for weeks at a time, leaving Faith to shop and browse the internet all day. One day, while home and missing Antonio because he hadn't been home in 9 days, she decided to Google Black Ice. Once she read the info about him, including that he was supposedly dead, she blurted out that she was the daughter of a psychopath. However, as she was saying it, Antonio walked in. They went basically straight to the bedroom, then he was leaving again. Faith questioned him about why he had to be at work in the AM when he normally works the third shift. He got an attitude, saying that she knew he was a doctor and to afford the condo and spoiling her made him now have to work doubles. They made up before he left though. Yeah, a week later, and Faith hadn't seen Antonio. She tried to turn on the lights, but they were out. The fridge was out and her phone wasn't working. Next thing you know, Black Ice was there, breathing down her neck. He pretty much told her she was weak, slow, and lets people walk all over her. He also wanted to know why she was choosing the life with Antonio. Was it love, luxury, money? He told her he had more money than anybody she knows, and that he was once in love, and that's how he ended up the way that he is. He told her love was an illusion, and that she needed to follow Antonio when he leaves the condo, claiming to be headed to work. After that, Black Ice pretty much vanished, and the lights were back on in the condo. Black Ice had left the weapons he had given to Faith at the hospital. He basically returned them to her. That's his reason for being there. Faith decided to take a bubble bath, and soon after she began her bath, Antonio walked in, getting out of his clothes and into the tub with her. They have a few minutes of pleasure, and then he is off to work again. So Faith gets out of the tub, gets dressed, grabs some money, and decides to follow him, as her dad suggested she do. So she hops in a cab and pays the cab driver to follow Antonio's Mercedes. She begins to feel like a fool when they were getting close to the hospital where he worked until he kept driving past it. They ended up in a whole different city and in a neighborhood where the homes were massive. The cab driver tried to tell her that usually these things don't turn out well in his experience. She said to herself that he may have been visiting relatives or something like that, you know, trying to make up an excuse for him. So she paid the cab driver another $100 to wait for her. As soon as she closed the door, the cab driver left smoke getting out of there. So Faith peeked through the windows, then walked around to the back where the sliding glass door was unlocked. She saw two teenage boys and a light-skinned lady. The boys were talking to the lady, calling her mom. Then Antonio, apparently still upstairs, speaking loudly and back and forth with the lady. They were all dressed up and ready to go to a play. Faith was watching them from the kitchen. Soon Antonio came down the stairs holding a little baby girl named Veronica. As he came down the stairs, he was explaining that he had to finish feeding Veronica. They were all talking about the play, and then Faith heard the two boys call Antonio dad as well. The boys looked to be seniors in high school or freshmen in college. Faith also saw Antonio kiss the light-skinned lady. Apparently, her name was Sabrina. The little girl he was holding looked just like Sabrina, and the two boys were identical twins and looked just like Antonio. After seeing what was going on, Faith couldn't take it, so she just yelled out, basically asking Antonio how could he do this to her. And then she ran into him, punching him while he was still holding the two-year-old. Sabrina screamed for them to call the cops, and the boys grabbed Faith and threatened her not to touch their sister. Antonio began explaining to his wife that Faith was a nobody and he was just using her for sex because he was a sex addict. Sabrina wasn't surprised because Faith was the third girl she had to pay off this year and also had to pay for abortions. Faith asked Antonio how could he do this to her and why did he lie to her. Antonio stated that he was never in love with her and that he would never leave his wife and family and that he would never be with her. With this knowledge, a mass amount of strength came over Faith and she was able to break from the twins who were both football players, and she began to attack Antonio as well as his baby daughter. She said, "You think it's fun to play with my life like that? Well, let me play with yours." She ended up kicking the child in the stomach so hard she flew into the other room underneath a coffee table. The twins were shocked that Faith was so strong. However, they both ran and got fire extinguishers. And while Faith was still attacking Antonio, they hit her in the head with the extinguishers, knocking Faith unconscious. Then Antonio and Sabrina began to plan what to do with Faith. They decided to get the twins to use rope to tie her up. Then they were going to take her to the middle of nowhere and drop her unconscious body off there. Then head back to the condo to clean up all of Faith's things so that he and Sabrina could start all over again, because he promised this would be the last side chick for him. Sabrina told him this better work and reminded him he's in the doghouse. As the twins were exporting Faith's body to be dropped off in the middle of nowhere, they decided they wanted to go pick up their best friends and have fun with Faith. Their best friends are Mako and Travis. They picked up their friends and headed out to Antonio's penthouse. Faith was still unconscious, but when she woke up, one of the twins was pumping in and out of her. She was tied up with rope from the shoulders to her waist and butt naked with her legs spread. Soon after one twin was done, the other one took his turn, but was complaining that she wasn't screaming. Faith lay there numb because she had been through this her whole life with her mother. Mako declared that he could make Faith scream. He took her to the bathroom, bent her over the tub, and decided to loosen the rope that was around her. The boy stood at the bathroom door watching, telling him it wasn't a good idea to loosen the rope. Mako slammed the door in their faces as he jammed himself into Faith's butthole. She did scream, but soon she turned around and dug dude's eyes out and then rammed the curling iron down his throat. Proceeded to show him how to do fellatio by taking Mako's penis into her mouth as far into her throat as she could get it. As Mako struggled to get the curling iron out of his throat due to swelling, Faith had got his penis where she wanted it, in her throat. Then she bit down as hard as she could, tugging side to side like an animal until it detached from his body. Mako tried to scream, but the curling iron was making it impossible. After biting off Mako's penis, she then grabbed some scissors and cut off his testicles, flipped him over on his stomach, and rammed a 12-inch dildo into his butthole. After that, she used a wet rag and a straight razor to stick in the socket that made the entire floor of the building lose power. The other boys were sitting in the living room watching TV, smoking weed when the power went out. Travis wondered what was taking Mako so long because he wanted his turn with the girl. Carson and Kevin were thinking about leaving anyway because they had a bad feeling about old girl after seeing what she did to their dad and little sister. Either way, Faith got a hold of the weapons her dad left for her and began to work on each boy one by one in the dark. Got out of bed when he noticed Sabrina wasn't there. He went downstairs to his wife feeding their daughter. Sabrina asked about the boys because she hadn't heard from them and told Antonio that Veronica hadn't stopped crying since being kicked and she felt like they needed to take her to the hospital. Antonio was against it, feeling like it would be reported and that they didn't need that. He also ended up talking reckless to his wife, which landed him getting cold clocked in the head with a glass object that knocked him off of his feet. Sabrina pretty much told him she was tired of him, his women, and all of the babies popping up. She was tired of putting up with the facade that their marriage was all good. She ended up taking off her wedding ring and throwing it at Antonio, then went back to feed her daughter. Antonio knew better than to say anything, so he held his head to stop the bleeding and proceeded to walk away and prepared to leave. Faith had taken the Escalade that belonged to the boys and waited until she saw Antonio leave the house in his Mercedes. She then pulled into the garage. Of course, Sabrina thought it was her son's, but couldn't see through the dark tent. She grabbed the baby and went to greet them by asking why didn't they call, but soon she was knocked in the head by something. When she looked down, she saw it was her son's head. Faith picked up the head and hit her with it again. Sabrina was knocked unconscious. When she came to, she heard water running and whimpering sounds. She was tied to a chair with bed sheets and had period blood stained panties stuffed in her mouth. Soon Faith entered the room with Veronica on her hip. That's the baby. The ladies talked briefly about what happened to the boys and why. Sabrina also discovered that the puppy's front legs had been cut off and fed to her. Faith stuffed the period panties back in Sabrina's mouth and drug the chair she had tied her up in right to the bathroom to watch her daughter being drowned and then her head being chopped off. Somehow Sabrina was able to get the period panties out of her mouth and she let out a horrible scream. And just before Faith was about to take Sabrina's head off, her swing was stopped by Black Ice's machete. He stopped Faith from killing her because he wanted Sabrina for himself. So they cleaned up and gathered their things and left. While Antonio was in the elevator, he was thinking to himself that he would be glad when this was all over and how he was going to throw all of Faith's things away or give them to the next girl. Then laughed to himself until he opened the door of his penthouse and saw the massacre that occurred. He saw bodies missing, limbs, blood, and guts everywhere. He knew that two of the bodies belonged to his sons because of the clothes they were wearing. Antonio intended on calling the cops, but sat there for 10 minutes trying to process everything, then called the cops after thinking of his wife and daughter. He told them someone may be trying to kill his wife, and then he flew from the condo and fled to his house. There he saw a lot of water and that the puppy was dead and missing limbs. He called out for his wife, getting no response. Then his phone rang and he saw it was his wife calling. He answered but only got Faith's voice. He attempted to cuss her out and threatened to kill her. Then Faith told him to go to his guest bathroom. There he saw his baby girl with her head chopped off in a tub full of bloody water. Faith told him she had everyone's head. At that point, Antonio dropped the phone, fell to his knees, screaming no as he held his daughter's lifeless body. Yeah, guys, this was something else. So anyway, let's get into my thoughts and opinions. I do want to say that I really wasn't planning on getting any more books by Shamike Spike because they are so gruesome. However, we are in quarantine and I do like to finish up on series. So I decided to go ahead and read it. Plus, Money Devils, The Cartel 8 won't be out until August. So we have to keep the reading room lit. So this is why I went on and read this one. So anyway, answer is, I don't understand why Regina tortured her daughter the way that she did. I feel like if she didn't want her based on who her father was, she could have had an abortion or given the girl up for adoption. I don't understand her logic. If you're afraid of the baby daddy, whom everyone knows as the devil, and felt like, you know, how did you feel like it was a good idea to torture his child? If you're scared of him, why are you torturing his child? That seems like, you know, that makes no sense. Especially when you also feared that the child would eventually turn to be just like him or turn into him. So you want to make them both angry and ferocious towards you. So I didn't understand her logic. But she was a crackhead, so I guess it made sense to her. Is I figured that Antonio was playing Faith for a fool from day one. Why would he try to have intercourse with the patient on the job? They're so sloppy and makes him look a bit creepy, as well as unethical and moralist. Then he also told her he had several homes and the condo he gave her the keys to. He told her he was hardly ever there. So I don't even understand why she began to question him when he told her that he would be MIA for weeks at a time. He told her from the beginning that he is never there. So why are you questioning this man when he is never there? He told you that. Then when he was there, it was just long enough to have intercourse with her and leave. Yet she still believed that he had a growing and blossoming relationship with her. It's like, are 20-year-olds really this naive these days? I really just can't believe that. He's telling you he has several homes and he's got you in one. With that being said, I would be questioning, like, okay, if you have several homes, then who's staying in these other ones? You met me at the hospital. So anyway, I'm actually glad she taught those little rapist boys a lesson. Though this was a hard lesson, but a lesson nonetheless. They are gross for wanting a woman their dad was with anyway, but she got them all. So the lesson here once again is that you can't keep abusing, torturing, and raping the innocent and think that your karma isn't coming. So for the sons, they got karma. For the dad, he got his karma too. So the next thing is, I feel like Sabrina and Veronica were innocent in all of this except for Sabrina's mouth. Brandy was also innocent and her life should have been spared. But for some reason, Faith took out the baby girl. I guess because she was Antonio's pride and joy. But I just feel like she shouldn't have did that. So once again, I'm gonna say it. You play with people. And then guess what? Your family is not off limits. They become a target too, paying for your debts. This is a lot of chaos due to a cheated spouse, but he should have thought about the consequences on every level before jumping in. He knew that the girl had been shot, beaten, and burned from the moment he started treating her at the hospital. So he knew her life wasn't a fairy tale. And also knew she wasn't a chump because she survived it all. However, her condition should have told him something before starting a sexual relationship with her. You have to be observant and study people, analyze their actions before giving them your soul. Same for Faith. Antonio displayed so many character flaws from the beginning that she should have questioned, but chose to ignore, blinded by lust. Trying to make out with patients in the hospital of his workplace. I mean, that tells you a lot right there. And wanting them to move in after knowing them for 2 weeks. Yeah. Anyway, doesn't sound very ethical, or it does sound like he lacks a few morals. So anyway, either way, this book was a short and easy read. Still gruesome, still disturbing. But it was an alright book. So let me know your feedback in the comment section, especially your thoughts and opinions. Did you read this book before? Have you read part two? And with that being said, there is a part two. However, I don't know if they have it in the paperback. I like to read paperbacks, not too much on the Kindle or anything like that. But if I'm able to find it, this will be the next book for the reading room. But if not, we will start on Murderville, the trilogy 1-3 by Ashlyn Jaquavis. Well, guys, I do want to thank you all for stopping by today and joining me in the reading room. I do really appreciate your time and energy. I hope to see you guys on the next video. Peace and love. And as always, be blissful.
DJ Mike C on the track.
Cause if you natural,
Lady D,
attack you, I keep my game tackled.
Yo,
yeah, I'm so nappy.
Cause
if you natural,
the infamous,
ain't looking tacky. Cause I keep my game tackled.
bucks. Lady, we won a lotto, cause in the Lord I trust. And beauty is the motto. Naturally thick in the butt, I'm Billy Blanks on the Tybo. Edges a little rough.